Hallelujah! Christ is risen!
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah!
Oh my God, you all hearts are open, and all desires known, and fucking no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and so worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God of our ancestors has glorified the servant Jesus, whom you came. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we will see Him as He is, and all who have His book in Him glorify themselves, just as He is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that He was revealed to take away sins, and in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him sins. No one who sins has either seen Him or known Him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That everything written about Me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms that thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from here, Jerusalem. You are my witnesses of all these things. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And then to top it off, we have an ornament in our house. It's almost the same size as she. sense, there are ghosts. There are things that bring to mind sacred realities that are no longer with us. The people that we are closest to, or even the pets that we love so dearly and so deeply, that insinuate themselves into our lives. Suddenly they depart from us. One day they're there, the next day they're not. But they're always sort of with us. We're always thinking. The mind never quite lets go. And so it's not unusual for these first disciples who have walked with Jesus, talked with Jesus, ate with Jesus, slept with Jesus, listened to Jesus' teaching, watched his miracles being worked for 3 long years. They left everything behind and followed him. It was an intense time that suddenly one day he is there and eating dinner with them, and then the next day he is not. And so it is no wonder that when Jesus appears to them after the resurrection, they think he's a ghost, a phantasm, a figment. We do it all the time. When someone we love in our family departs from our life, we're always watching them, waiting for them to come home through the door, around the corner, sit at the table, whatever it is. It took me 3 long years finally to erase my father's telephone number from speed dial after he passed. So, Jesus comes to them, and well aware that this is probably what they're thinking, he says to them, "I'm not a ghost." You know, of course, this is the ancient world. Ghosts were very much a part of people's awareness in those days. He said, "I'm not a ghost, don't worry. Look, see." Last week we heard about Thomas and all of his doubting and so on. Luke tells a little different story. He kind of puts that on all the disciples, not just for Thomas. But they're not quite getting it. They're not quite understanding this. That Jesus is risen from the dead. He is not a ghost. There is the reality of Jesus in the flesh. It is changed and transformed. It is qualitatively different than he was before, but it's still Jesus. And he's there. And he goes so far as to say, give me something to eat. This is a ghost with something to eat, put in his mouth, and suddenly it'd be on the floor, just walk right through. No, but Jesus ate it. And it disappeared, just like any other human being. Jesus was alive. And it is no wonder, too, that they were disbelieving. They were bewildered, and they were in wonderment. How can this be? It only goes to say that when we have these feelings, when we look around ourselves and we see awful things happening, whether it is the death of a beloved pet or someone else becomes ill with a debilitating and even terminal illness, sometimes we just cannot believe that it's happening. These awful things are happening. And eventually somebody will die who's dear to us, and we need to let go and say goodbye. We entrust them, as we say, into the hand of the Lord. We say those things, but haven't we really, except that we're still expecting them to walk through the door, to sit at the table, to pick up the phone? These feelings are real. And so is Jesus coming to us in the flesh. It is in a changed and transformed way. Jesus cannot be physically present in his body as Jesus rose from the dead to each and every human person in the world for generation upon generation through these 2 millennia. And so Jesus did something fantastic. He breathes on them and he tells them to receive the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that was the dynamic power that Jesus' body from the dead. Jesus is not simply a disembodied spirit. Jesus is Jesus, the human person who came to live among us in the flesh. And it is the same Jesus that says to us, Receive the same Spirit. Let it come into you. Let it seep down into you. Let it insinuate itself into your very fiber of your being, and then realize that I live. And as you live your life day after day, you too will be transformed and changed until that marvelous day when all will be revealed and we will see Jesus as he is. And when we do that wonderful teaching from one of the ancient patristic teachers of the church, God became a human so that we could become as gods. That process has already begun. The same process that raised Jesus from the dead has already begun. And we say in our statements of faith, we believe in the resurrection of the dead. How that's going to happen, what it's going to look like, don't concern yourself about that. It is the reality of the life of God in our world. In a way that we can see and touch and smell and love. That is what sustains us. When we have to say goodbye to something or someone we love so dearly. That is what sustains us when we look around the world and it seems to be falling apart at the seams. That's what sustains us when it seems that a tiny little thing called a virus could overcome humanity. Or it seems like that sometimes. And yet it is the Spirit of God that moves us to action. To take care of one another. To do the things that are necessary to overcome this challenge. It is but one more challenge placed before us to remind us that we are not all powerful. And there is but one. As we began this sermon, the one God, living and true, Father, Son, and Spirit. And it is that God that has chosen to dwell in your hearts. So that when we look at the world around us, we can be fearful, disbelieving, bewildered, afraid. But it is Jesus who stands before us this day, in the words of sacred scripture given to us generation after generation, with the witness of the Spirit in each generation for 2,000 years, saying, peace. That peace which originates in the heart, the peace of Christ, which brings healing and wholeness in the face of illness, suffering, and division. That's why we tell this story. So that we will be changed and transformed, very much like Peter was. As we heard in the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, that regardless of how he himself was fearful of what he was about to do, he went out and proclaimed Christ crucified and risen from the dead. And in so doing, one for Christ, one for God, a following that has endured in these many years, and now is our responsibility to proclaim that good news that Jesus lives. Christus vincit. Christ has conquered. Christus reigns. That Christ reigns, governs our hearts and our minds and our souls. Christus imperans. That he is the one over all nations. And it is this same one who stands before you today and would say, if he could be with us in the body, see my hands, see my feet, give me a flesh. Do not be afraid. I'm not some disembodied spirit that will fall away, disappear with the light. Jesus tells us not to be afraid. It is faith that encourages us and strengthens us. So now let us stand together and profess this faith in the church which we have received to a broken world. For we believe in one God, the Father and the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being, the Father. Through him all things are made, for us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God has made the one who was rejected the cornerstone of a new community of faith. In the name of Christ Jesus, let us pray for the needs of our world, saying, hear us, O God. Your mercy is grace.
Holy One, as a risen Christ opened the minds of the disciples to understand the Scriptures and gave them power for the Holy Spirit to walk boldly in this world, open your people today to healing, wisdom, and faith given in your word.
Hear us, O God, your mercy is grace.
Prince of Peace, as Christ Jesus showed us his wounded hand, terrified apostles, reveal to your church and to the people of prayer and true faith the wounds of our neighbors, the fears of individuals and families, and the avenues for healing. Remember especially the Church of Ireland, St. Margaret of Emmaus, St. Matthew's Society, the Diocese of Cabo Cagey, and their bishop, Manuel Moray, and Luba Lake Parish, Cobey Parish.
Hear us, O God.
Author of life, we beg for peace among nations, peace throughout communities, peace within families. We ask you to guide our leaders, especially Joseph, our president, and Tom, our governor, as well as voters, legislators, judges, and juries. Teach us respect for one another in all our ways, so that all your creation may thrive. Joan, Carolyn, and Andrew Hefner, and those and any who's concerned life on our part.
Trusting in your abundant mercy, O God, we commend to your care all for whom we pray, and our own lives, all through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
And so, my friends, may the peace of the risen Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Just before we go to the altar to prepare, I have one announcement that I'd like to make. It's good news. We always need lots of good news. You may see that somebody's missing here. It's not a bad thing. Last week, our own Lisa Herzing, or Lisa Erzitz, or Lisa Erzitz Herzing, depending on how long she wants to be known in any moment, gave birth to a beautiful and healthy baby. So give thanks to God for a new life in our midst as we go to the altar to give thanks for all that God has done for us in Christ Jesus.
Thank you.
God, who sent your only Son to be born of a woman, to fulfill your law, and to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By your blood, we are baptized, by your wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus of prophets and apostles and martyrs, with all those in every generation, who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory.
Power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
hearts of